Hi, welcome back. I'm Chris Hitchens, your college admissions coach, member of the Bethel Park Chamber of Commerce, and it is still summer, you can tell by my attire. And I promised that this session we were going to talk about financial aid. And it's not going to be the topics you think we're going to talk about, because most people are well versed in the types of financial aid. But I want to point out a couple details. First of all, most financial aid is going to come, we're jumping right in, most financial aid is going to come directly from the colleges. The vast majority is coming from the colleges. So if you're looking for financial aid or tuition reduction or tuition credit, you want to look at, honestly, the first thing you're going to look at is our grades and SAT scores. So if you're looking for financial aid, grants from the school or the government, most of them are going to be based on the classes the student takes, grades, and SAT scores. So those are the things families should focus on. Also, obviously, there's going to be loans, which truly, if you're looking at planning for college, I don't care how old your kids are right now, you should talk to a financial planner. Whether your kids are 2 or they're 17, you should truly talk to a financial planner. The issues with student loans can get out of control. We all know that. So, but there are reasons for that. And the reasons are mostly based on poor planning and easy credit. So truly, you want to think about not just today, but where are you going to be 4 years from now when that student graduates from college? But truly, the earlier you start planning ahead, even if you don't have a lot of money to save, at least have an idea of where things are going to end up. So you have most of the information or the money is going to come from the colleges and the government. We're going to talk about work study a little bit later in the question and answer session. There are loans, there are different types of loans, there are subsidized loans, unsubsidized loans, but honestly, I want to talk about money. It's sort of coming from a different avenue. About 80% of the families who plan on sending their child to college go about it in an inefficient manner and waste tens of thousands of dollars. So when we talk about financial aid, where's financial aid come from? It comes from the schools. That means don't look at one school. Don't look at 3 schools. Don't look at 5 schools. Look at 15 schools. Look at 20 schools. Look at schools you've never heard of. I know most students want to go to a college that's within a 3-hour driving radius, about 180 miles. Within that 3-hour radius, it encompasses a great number of schools, and it encompasses probably a large number of schools you've never heard of. These are schools you should investigate. So if you want to optimize your financial aid, you want to look through and sort through a large number of colleges. Money's going to come from the colleges. Every college is not the same. Every child is not the same. And every college does not view every child like every other college views that child. They may see attributes in your student that other colleges don't value. And that's where financial aid can be enhanced. So we're going to look for schools. Now, this is one thing parents struggle with. Have the talk with the students. If my son or daughter came up to me and said, I'm getting married, I need $280,000 for my wedding, how would you feel about that? Well, there's a budget for the wedding, there's a budget for the car, there's a budget for the mortgage, there needs to be a budget for the college. And so many parents are afraid to have the talk with the students and say, there's a budget. This is how much money we are willing to contribute. This is how much money you can borrow safely. So when you graduate, it's not overwhelming. And this is where the money is going to be how it's going to be allotted and where it's coming from. So that means there are certain colleges that we are not going to be able to accept admission from. We can apply. Some colleges, honestly, the most expensive colleges are the most generous colleges. So if there's a college that your student fits into that's going to be generous with your student, by all means, apply. But that doesn't mean if they come back and say it's $65,000 per year or even $40,000 per year and we're not offering that much financial aid, we cannot go there. So have this talk. And if your college turns out, if your student turns out that they're going to start off with community college, that's awesome. They're going to go to a Penn State branch campus or a Pitt branch campus, fantastic. They have to start somewhere. But do not get overwhelmed. Do not let, I hate to say this, but do not let the students drive the process. The parents have to drive the process. The parents have the experience, the money, they have the forethought and the insight to make more informed decisions. So don't let the student drive. So many parents don't want to disappoint their students that the parents run into issues and the students truly run into issues. So that's my suggestion. Take control of the process. Evaluate a large number of schools. Start early. I'm getting calls now from parents saying my student's going to be a senior in about 3 weeks. That's late. That's about a year late if you're going to be comparing colleges. If my child was an athlete, I would look at the end of their sophomore year to start contacting colleges and coaches. If my child was a junior, now's the time to start. If you're serious about saving money and you're serious about financial aid, SAT prep, no doubt. We're going to talk about SAT prep in the question and answer segment. Financial planner, a lot of these planners will meet with you for free initially. They would like to turn you into a client, but they'd also like to make you a long-term client. So they're not used car salesmen. They want to help you along the line and then help your student. So they're going to be offering their services. And I have a number that I trust, that I work with, that I refer. So you can contact me, but truly bring in the experts. Do not wait for your high school guidance counselors to take control of the situation. They have 400 students they are working with, each one of them. You need to take control of the situation. If your kid's student's an athlete, you need to take care of the situation. Don't wait for the coach. You need to take control of the situation. And they can be great resources, the coach and the guidance counselor, but the family has to take control of the situation and the student has to take the initiative. I'm saying this constantly. Students don't want to take the initiative to sign up for SAT prep. They don't want to investigate the colleges. They don't want to look at outside scholarships. And then they grumble and they blame the counselors or the coaches saying they're not doing their job, and that is not the case. So plan ahead. Investigate as many schools as you can and visit. Once you start the process, the piece will start to fall into place. All right, that ends our first segment. Come on back. We're going to bring in Heather Campbell from Club Z Tutoring. We'll be right back. Welcome back. I'm Chris Hitchens, your college admissions coach, member of the Bethel Park Chamber of Commerce. And in this segment, I'm joined by Heather Campbell from Club Z Tutoring. Welcome back, Heather.
Thanks, Chris. Happy to be back.
Nice to see you. Always welcome your contributions.
Absolutely.
What are we going to talk about today?
Well, I thought for this time of year, a lot of people are making their final plans to transition to college.
Yes.
And that's a big step for a lot of parents as well as incoming freshmen.
A lot of tears, a lot of goodbyes, a lot of planning.
Yeah, absolutely. So I figured we could talk about how parents can find the right balance in that transition.
Often neglected parents.
Yeah, absolutely. So it can be really overwhelming for parents of college freshmen who are now adults to strike that healthy balance and adequately prepare their children for college. And sometimes you hear this term helicopter parenting, which is a lot of hovering and preparing and planning for the children. And actually, a little bit of hovering is not a bad thing. According to courts.com, a clinical licensed social worker named Diane Barth wrote an article that suggests healthy, positive parental involvement that doesn't overstep into helicopter territory is very good for kids striking out on their own.
I mean, sometimes that's a fine line.
Absolutely. And so there are some guidelines that she lays out that really can help parents understand that balance and the interactions that can happen, because you don't want to be running into the problem of how are things, and if the student is away from the family, like an hour, a couple of hours across the country, it can be hard hard to stay involved and feel like you know what's going on.
Definitely.
So one of the first things that they can do is to guide the student but not pressure them.
Okay.
To respect their point of view and their need to exercise their newfound independence.
I bet that's very difficult for a lot of parents.
Absolutely. And listening more than they're talking.
Exactly.
So asking open-ended questions are really important, because if you ask a yes-no question, that's what you're going to get.
Yeah.
Is yep. Nope.
Good.
Which good. I think all parents have been in that boat over the high school career and even a little bit earlier as kids start to assert their independence at different levels.
Definitely a skill that sometimes you have to work on and develop is that communication skill with your kid.
For sure. Absolutely. Actively expressing your interest in what they're telling you by asking follow-up questions. So you're actually listening to what their response is and asking questions that let them describe it in more detail or let them know that you're listening is really important. And then also, I think sometimes parents forget to share things that's happening in their own lives.
Sure.
You know, giving that give and take, you know, shifting a more balanced from an egalitarian model of conversation to sharing in part of the conversation about how your life has changed with them not being there,
yes.
with different activities that you're now doing, things
right.
like that. So the kids don't feel like it's always interrogation.
Right, right. You can talk about their empty nest anxiety.
Exactly, exactly. And initiating conversations about their expectations for the new relationship. I think a lot of times parents skirt that because they don't know what's in store. Their child is now an adult, and what does that look like?
Right, especially now they're going to be away for a number of months, and then they come home, and now they're 18, they had newfound freedom.
Mm-hmm.
How are we going to deal with this?
Yes,
the time
exactly.
we be home tonight.
Exactly. Mm. So parents really can be direct about conversations about drug and alcohol abuse, finances, roommate arrangements, curfews, when their expectations are, things like that. You know, being respectful of other children in the home or of the parents, you know, being worried and things like that. So having that direct conversation is sometimes really good. You know, it's things that if you skirt around, then arguments will happen more likely than not.
Yeah, so we hear about that. And I think one thing parents can do with students of any age is to start these conversations early.
Yes.
You can start these boundary conversations, you know, what's going to happen. We're going to talk about, you know, drugs and alcohol and peer pressure and things like that. And, you know, even being independent. And then, you know, our expectations, even when you turn 18, what are your expectations when you move back? And I'm going to set this now when you're 12. So when you're 18, you realize you may still have a curfew.
This isn't a new conversation.
This is not a new conversation. This is my expectation. So
yeah, absolutely. And there are tons of milestones that you can have these conversations with kids when they transition to middle school or when they are staying home alone for the first times and things of that nature. You know, and then they expect boundaries from you rather than this is a new thing all of a sudden.
Right.
And allowing for mistakes while encouraging your child to recognize and respond appropriately to situations, whether they're dangerous or foolhardy. You know, I think we've all made our own good and bad choices in life. And so allowing your child to also make those mistakes is how we learn and grow, you know. Sometimes you just have to go through it in order to learn the lesson.
Growing pains, yes.
Yeah. And then you can both learn from the experiences, too. And then reminding them that asking for help is not a sign of weakness.
Sure.
You know, if they get in too deep, if they need help. I know for a lot of incoming freshmen, they get their first credit card.
Oh, boy.
And
yes,
credit card debt
all the time. Sure.
is a really big struggle. Some parents do it better than others.
There are predators out there who want to issue this credit to families or kids that are not prepared.
I know when I went to college, my first card came in the mail, like didn't even have to apply.
Oh,
it was crazy. And they had vendors on campus that were allowed to come out and sign you up. And there you go. You now have $10,000 that you don't realize all the time is not your money.
Right.
So that can be a hard lesson to learn. And just opening up those lines of communication so they don't feel embarrassed and they just keep getting further and further and spiraling and things like that. Or if they made a mistake and they drank too much at a party or something like that, being able to share that is huge, you know, that they know that they can talk with you.
It's definitely a transition and definitely milestones.
Mm-hmm. And there are college resources, I think we've talked about in the past, for students, but also for parents.
Oh,
you know, so finding those resources, going to parent orientation sessions, and when you take your student to college and attending some workshops for parents are really important, and that will get you into that culture that your student is now
that you
in.
You have the support. There is a village back there somewhere.
Exactly.
And you have resources. If something does come up, you know who to, at least you have an avenue to follow.
Absolutely. So I hope this was really helpful.
It's awesome. Great. I think parents are neglected in this whole process. So they need the support also.
Yeah, definitely.
We support them, they can support the student even better.
Absolutely.
I agree. So this takes us to the end of this segment. I want to welcome Heather Campbell from Club Z Tutoring. Again, I'm Chris Hitchens, college admissions coach, member of the Chamber, Bethel Park Chamber of Commerce, and stick with us. We'll be back with a viewer mailbag. Hi, welcome back. I'm Chris Hitchens, your college admissions coach. I want to thank Heather Campbell for being here with us. And now we're going to start our viewer mailbag. First, Jill writes in. Jill writes, son applied for FAFSA and received subsidized instead of unsubsidized loan. Isn't the unsubsidized better, and how does one apply for one versus the other? Jill, unfortunately, had that reversed. Subsidized is better, and usually it's for a lesser amount than the unsubsidized that they offer. Subsidized means that there's no interest accruing during the student's college career. If you do have unsubsidized loans, the interest is accruing. I recommend, and you can talk to your financial planner, of paying the interest, if it's just the interest only, on these loans. It may be $5, $10, $15, $20 a month. You'll save yourself thousands of dollars. And it's not how does one apply for one over the other. They are being offered by the colleges, by the college, and usually don't have a say unless you go outside and get a private loan. From Samantha. Looking at campus safety and security websites, shocked at the difference in the stats between some schools. Curious if anyone has insight as to whether it is possible that some schools don't enforce as much so their stats look better. Primary differences, drug and alcohol violations. All right, so the thing with colleges, until recently, colleges truly underreported any types of violations. But now they're being mandated, so these violations should be reported. So if you're investigating these types of things and you're basing your decisions on these, that's perfectly fine. I don't blame you. So it's hard to imagine schools are underreporting, and they probably are enforcing, but that's not enough. So I would look at different forums, different Facebook pages, and I would ask questions out there from people you know. And there's ways to investigate the safety factor of different college campuses. And you're right, there's probably a gigantic difference between different types of colleges. Tammy, my daughter is a softball player and currently being recruited by some D2 and D3 schools. D3 schools only give merit scholarships, right? There's no athletic scholarships for Division III schools. She's a junior with a GPA 3.4. We did not qualify for anything other than loans based on our previous two kids in college. We don't want her taking out big loans. Do you have any experience with athletes at D2, especially D3 schools, in their distribution of scholarships? All right, so junior year, now's the time you really want to start contacting the coaches. Maybe it's slightly late, but I think there's still time. Division II does offer scholarships. They won't be as substantial as Division I, so it's very, very difficult to find a full scholarship for a sport like softball. Unless you're football or basketball, it's tough to find full rides. But they do have money to offer. Division III will not offer athletic scholarships, but they do have a number of different types of grants, and every school is different. So here's what I'm going to suggest, and start right away. Investigate the schools your student will consider, and you will consider. It may be 5 schools, 10 schools, 15 schools, 20 schools. You may want to contact 30 schools, 40 schools, 50 schools. Contact the coach. Tell them about yourself. You're going to plan, if you're serious about playing in school, you want to plan out a highlight video. If you contact me, I have a do-it-yourself guide for free. I'll be glad to send it out to you. But there's ways to contact the coaches and find that best fit. You're looking at a dual application. You need to get a school that fits academically and fits athletically. And so now is the time to start. Contact as many schools as you can. You're not going to get a high percentage of return correspondence, but this is the place to start. You really, truly have to beat the bushes. It may be well worth it. From Annie. Hi. I have a 5-year-old who I hope will attend college someday without breaking the bank. I've been looking for resources to start applying early. Yes, this may sound too early, but I'm a planner and trying to set her up for a debt-free graduation. Any recommendations or suggestions for my very early scholarship search? I don't have any recommendations for scholarship searches, but I do admire the planning aspect. And yes, 5 years old, this is a fantastic time to meet with a financial planner. And you find a good financial planner and they'll work almost like a life coach with you. They'll offer suggestions on how to save, how much to save. He'll help you set goals. He will help you meet these goals. He will put you on a path that will possibly help you gradually increase the money you're putting away for college. If there's going to be additional students, if you need a recommendation, you can contact me. I work with a number of financial planners. And honestly, the good ones will work as a life coach. And they want to be your financial planning coach for the rest of your life. And so the good ones will treat you well and not stress you out and not put you in a situation that's uncomfortable for you. But truly, they're the people to talk to. Find a good one, and I can help you if you want. From Angela, I can't afford SAT, ACT prep courses. What are some free resources to prep for SAT? It's so sad, disadvantaged single parents don't have the access that other parents have. Praying for a miracle. All right, so I'm going to recommend, if the school doesn't do a good job of SAT prep, your high school, I'm going to recommend Khan Academy. I have no affiliation with Khan Academy, but I know Khan Academy. I know the results that can happen from using Khan Academy properly. Khan Academy can link up with a student's PSATs and come out with a curriculum designed based on their strengths and weaknesses to help them prep for the SAT and the ACT. So now, the problem with Khan Academy is that it's online and there's no one to guide you through it. So that means the student needs to be very self-motivated or the parent needs to stay on top of the whole situation. It can be extremely worthwhile. It is worth the time and effort. And it's absolutely free. Again, I have no affiliation, but I can strongly recommend if you're looking for a resource, it's tough to make it work because there's no oversight. But the people and the families, the students who do work this process in Khan Academy, they benefit a great deal. And truly, this could mean a lot of money because money is staged based on SAT scores and grades. I truly believe it's worth your while. From Anne, work study versus a job on campus. What are the differences in tax implications or the impact on FAFSA? Work study or job on campus? All right, there are advantages to work study. Work study will not affect your FAFSA, which means the family's contribution to the child's education. So they can earn money through work study. It won't affect the FAFSA. Also is not affected by FICA. And so the tax implications are a lot less through work study as opposed to a job on campus. I love both ideas. I honestly think students who work through work study or have a job on campus, I truly, truly believe they enjoy college more. I think they get better grades. Honestly, 10, 15, even 18 hours per week is no excuse for not keeping up with your studies. And students, especially in work study, they get to meet a lot of people on campus affiliated with the school. So I think it's truly worthwhile. Well, that ends question and answer period for this session of your college admission coach. Again, I'm Chris Hitchens. I want to again thank Heather Campbell for joining us, and we'll see you next week.